Hello everyone, welcome to Indian Judicial Service. Today we are covering question number 126 to 150. This is the part 6 of top 300 MCQ of Indian Evidence Act. These questions are very important for the students who are preparing the judicial examination and police recruitment and other examination. Let's now start here. Question number 126. In case of will, the period of 30 years shall run from the date of will, from the date of death of testator, from the date of registration of the will, if registered, either A or B. So here answer is, option A is here, from the date of will. Question number 127. The presumption as to a genuineness of gazette. So genuineness of gazette in electronic form has been dealt with the under Section 81A of Evidence Act, Section 88A of Evidence Act, Section 90A of Evidence Act, Section 73A of Evidence Act. So here answer is, option A is correct, Section 81 of A of Evidence Act. And the Section 81A of Evidence Act provide the genuineness of gazette in electronic form has been. Okay, question number 128. Section 88A of Evidence Act provide for presumption as to the electronic message forwarded that correspond with the message in fed in the computer, presumption as to the person by whom the message is sent, both A and B, only B, not A. So here answer is option A is correct, presumption as Section 88A of Evidence Act provide presumption as to the electronic record, electronic message forwarded the correspond with the message fed in the computer. Question number 129. Electronic record in proper custody, this is important here, proper custody gives rise a presumption as to the digital signature that to be affixed by the particular person under Section 90A of Evidence Act if the electronic record provided is, option A 20 year, option B 15 year, 10 year and 5 year. So here answer is option D, 5 year. Question number 130. Section 90 of Evidence Act apply to, so Section 91 of Evidence Act apply to transaction which under the law must be in writing. The transaction which are reduced into writing voluntarily, both A and B, only A, not B. So here answer is both A and B, must in writing and voluntarily in writing. Question number 131. Section 91 Evidence Act provide the permit admission of oral evidence to approve the content of document where a writing is a fact in issue. This is a very important point here. The probity prohibits the admission of oral evidence to prove the content of document where a writing is a fact in issue. The probity admission of oral evidence to prove the contents of document where a writing is not a fact in issue and it is merely collateral memorandum, both B and C. So here answer is option B is correct, provide the admission of oral evidence to prove the content of document where a writing is a fact in issue. Question number Question number 132. The section 91 of Evidence Act apply to a document which are unilateral, bilateral, tripartite, and all of the above. So here answer is option D is correct. Unilateral, bilateral, and tripartite. Section 33. Question number 133. Section 91 of Evidence Act provide the admission of oral evidence as to existence or non-existence of factum. Option B, the permit the admission of oral evidence as to a existence or non-existence of factum, but the prohibit the admission of oral evidence of terms of factum if in existence. Option C, the prohibit the admission of oral evidence as to the existence and non-existence of factum and also a term of factum if in existence. Both A and C. So here answer is option B is correct. Here the permit admission of oral evidence as the existence or non-existence of a factum prohibits the admission of oral evidence in the term of factum if in existence. Question number 134. The section 92 of Evidence Act prohibits the admission of oral evidence in respect of written document for the purpose of contradicting its term, varying its term, adding its term, all of the above. So section 92 of Evidence Act prohibits the admission of oral evidence in respect of written document. So here answer is option all of the above, means contradict its term, varying its term, and adding it to its term. So the provision of section 92 is exclusion of oral evidence. The 92 provide the exclusion of oral evidence. So 92 provide the exclusion of oral evidence. So there the content of document must be proved by the documents, original document or document certified copy. So here question number 135. Section 92 of Evidence Act is applied to dispute between the party to the instrument only, dispute between the party to the instrument and a stranger, dispute between the party to stranger where the document is in question. So option D, all of the above. So here answer is option A is correct. Here the section 92 of Evidence Act applicable with the disputes between party to the instrument only. Question number 136. Section 92 of Evidence Act apply to unilateral, bilateral, both A and B, and neither A nor B. So here answer is option D is correct. Here 92, section 92 provide the bilateral document. Question number 137. Oral evidence of fact invalidating the document is admissible under the proviso first to section 92 of Evidence Act proviso, second to section 92 of Evidence Act proviso 4 of section 92 of Evidence Act proviso 6 of 92 of Evidence Act. So these are the very important here. Section 92 is very important here because section proviso first provide the I expressed all the provisos of this sections, section 92. So first the legality of document is provided, proviso first. So provided for the legality of document. Proviso second, provide the document when the document is silent. The oral evidence is given when the document is silent. document is silent. When the document is silent, the oral evidence is given. Proviso third is the separate the oral agreement. If there is a separate oral agreement, so option third is not available, but the proviso third of section 92 is provide the separate oral agreement between the document agreement, written agreement. And proviso 6 provide where the manner of language of document is related to the existing fact. So manner of language, language is very important. Manner of language, language of document related to existing fact. Existing fact. So according to the question 137, the oral evidence fact the invalidating the document is admissible. So here answer is option A, proviso first of section 92. Question number 138, the want and or failure of consideration as the contemplated under proviso first of section 92 of Evidence Act invalidating a document. Option A, the complete want or failure, the partial want or failure, substantial want or failure, may be complete and may be partial want or failure. So here answer is option A is correct. Here option A is correct, a complete want or failure. Question number 139, the mistake refer to in proviso first section 92 of Evidence Act refer to unilateral mistake, mutual mistake. Section 92, very important question, many times this question asked in different judicial examination. Both A and B, and option D, only A, only B, not A. So here answer is option C is correct. C is correct here means unilateral mistake and mutual mistakes, both are provided in the proviso first of section 92. Question number 140, under section 92 of evidence act, the oral evidence to explain the real nature of the transition is admissible. So section 92 Evidence Act, oral evidence to explain the real nature of the transaction is admissible. So here answer is option A is correct here, where the document does not record all the terms of the contract. So this is also refer the liability of document. So all the where the document does not refer the record the all the terms of document, the such document is not valid document, it may be proved. Question number 141, under proviso 2 of section 92 of Evidence Act, the oral evidence is admissible where a instrument provide for matter sought to be proved and the agreement sought to be proved it's consistent with the terms of the document, where the instrument is silent. Yes, it is very important word here, instrument is silent on matter sought to be proved and the agreement to be proved to consistent with the terms of document. Option C, where the instrument is silent on the matter sought to be proved and the agreement to be proved is inconsistent. In previous option there is a consistent, and there is in option C inconsistent with the term of document. Option D, all of the above. So question number 141, answer is where the document is silent, first keyword is important, on the matter sought to be proved and the agreement to be proved the consistent with the term of document. Question number 142, under the proviso 4 section 92 of Evidence Act, oral evidence is admissible in cases where the contract has been written voluntarily, not required by law to be so written. where the law requires the contract to be written, where a contract has been registered under the law of registration act of document, all of the above. So here answer proviso 4 provided of proviso 4 of section 92 of evidence act 1872 provided the where the content of document, option A is here, where the content of document has been written voluntarily, not required by law to be so written. So option A is correct here, answer of this question. Question number 143, the extrinsic evidence to shows the meaning or a supply the defect of an instrument and its probity under section 93 in respect of ambiguous patent, ambiguous, latent, both A and B, and only B, not A. So here answer is ambiguous patents here, not latent, only patent here. Question number 144, the test of ascertaining on which side the burden of proof lie is contained in section 100 of evidence act 101, 102, 103. So the test of uncertain means there is no certain. So option A 100, 101, 102, 103. So here answer is 102 of Evidence Act. That 102 is provided the onus provendi. The maxim very important here. Onus provendi. It means the burden of proof is not certain, it's shifting continuously one party to another party to against same party, another party. So it is onus provendi, it is the onus of proof, and burden of proof is provided under section 101 of Evidence Act. So here option C is correct. Question number 145, burden of proof means the burden of proof is as a matter of law, and pleading is a burden of establishing a case. The burden of proof as to an introduction of evidence, both A and B, and option D, only B, not A. So here answer is option C is correct here, both A and B. Means the burden of proof means burden of proof is a matter of law. This is very important. Burden of proof is a matter of law, not matter of fact. It is a matter of law. And pleading is a burden of establishing a case. And option B is here. The burden of proof is a introduction of evidence. So here three things is important here. Burden of proof is the matter of law. First, matter of law. Second, the pleading is a burden of establishing the case. And third important point here, introduction of the evidence. Because when we are establishing the plant before the court, we are attaching all the evidence along with the plant or WS. So burden of proof is always on the plaintiff. Question number 147, burden of proof partially determine the right to begin, the substantially determine right to begin, wholly determine right to begin, only C, not, and not A and B. So option A is correct here, partially determine right to begin, and those who are starting the proceeding, those who are plaintiffs and who has the burden of proof to prove their evidence before the court. In criminal case, it is always in plaintiff In civil case, it is always in plaintiff, but in criminal case, it is always in prosecution. Means a person who are fighting or who are represent the victim and having the burden of proof. Means there are some exceptions, and the person who are showing that his case is belong to the general exception of Indian Penal Code. So in that case, is the burden of proof. This is the special case, in the burden of proof on the accused. But in general way, the burden of proof in criminal matters always on the prosecution. Question number 147. The burden of proof under Section 101 of Evidence Act never shifted and goes on shifted as the trial proceeding may shift B and C. I already expressed burden of proof is never shifted. Onus of proof means onus probandi. Section 102 is shifting continuously, but 101 burden of proof never shifted. So here answer is option A is correct here. Question number 148. Burden of proof is lightened by presumption, admission, estoppel, all of the above. So here answer all of the above. Burden of proof is lightened, the presumption, admission and estoppel. Question number 149. Burden of introducing the evidence under Section 102 of Evidence Act never shift, occasionally shift, constantly shift. Here this is very important, shift, and only A, not B and C. So I already expressed the Section 102 provide the onus probandi. So in such condition, the burden of proof is constantly shifted. So answer option C is correct here, according to Section 102. Now come to the final question of this part. Question number 150. The criminal proceeding. In criminal proceeding, the burden of proof is on the prosecution to prove the guilty of accused, on the accused to prove he is innocent, both parties either A. I already expressed this question. The burden of proof in criminal proceeding is always upon the prosecution to prove that the accused is guilty for that offense and who is committing by him. So here answer is option A is correct. On the prosecution to prove the guilty of the accused. Thank you friends to watching this video, and if you like this video, please click on like button and share this video to your friends. Thank you for watching.